Don't need to introduce myself, right? Just Tenzin is fine. Let me begin with a simple question. How many of you woke up this morning and said to yourself, beautiful day here, I plan to be angry and miserable all day today? Nobody. How many of you recall waking up yesterday saying, I'm already in this beautiful island, or I have to travel to this beautiful island, and the first thought is, I plan to be envious and jealous all day today? No one? Do you recall any day of your life when you woke up and the first thought was, I plan to be angry, miserable, hateful, jealous all day today? Now, how many of you on any given day experience some level of anger or agitation? Some level of anxiety? Fear? Okay. So part of, you know, the curiosity that even early monastics and Buddhist monasteries go through is that there are a few things that we human beings are very good at planning. At least we think we are. And then there are a couple of things that just occur, that just happen. And at what point does our planning become so good that we are even able to plan, even begin to sort of have a greater degree of control or ability to regulate certain forms of mental states or certain forms of emotional states and so on? So that's the kind of curiosity or training that in traditional monastic curriculum we spend a bit of time exploring. Now, the topic of my talk was around rethinking education, and I decided on this topic before I knew that the conference was focused on social-emotional learning. So I'll just keep it around rethinking on a broad basis. And this is not the first time that, as a society, we are sort of rethinking, you know, what education should be or what educational institutions should be doing. This has been a conversation that has happened sometimes in an organized fashion, sometimes haphazardly for the last 200 years or so. But one of the challenges that has happened with institutions is that oftentimes the approach in education system to focus on something has been sort of rather reactive. When we see certain kinds of demands in society, or we see certain kinds of things that we are not measuring up to, that we see a gap, we suddenly decide that this would be a good thing to focus on. And this is something that we should sort of invest a lot of time in doing so. And that's how, you know, we develop the capacity for nurturing students or educating students in certain kinds of skill sets, whether it has to do with STEM subjects or whether it has to do with particular kinds of professional skill sets and so on. And this morning I was talking to one of my colleagues, and I was informed that one of the earliest sort of organized studies, longitudinal studies and behavioral stuff around social and emotional things, were done in 1920s and 30s with a sample of 8,000 students, 8,000 data, all over Europe and Eastern Europe. And the day it was published was the day the United States decided to go into Second World War. And so it ended up being not in the front page of the news. Something else took over. But the reason I'm suggesting this is because the preoccupation, or sort of the curiosity around how emotional regulations, how certain kinds of behavioral facets are important in studies in educational institutions, has been sort of something that a lot of individuals have thought about and have try to ascertain what the best mechanism is. And of course, I won't go into the theory part of it, but most of you are aware of it. There are different schools, from John Dewey to Rudolf Steiner to, who else should we pick on, Piaget. Okay. That there are different kinds of thought about it as to what one should focus on. Now, my role at MIT is slightly interesting, although I don't like the word interesting very much. Is that I come from a background where I received both traditional education and monastic education, traditional as in the Western sense of traditional. And I came to MIT, and much of my work initially was around experimental work, and then I got to Media Lab, where the Media Lab takes pride in the idea of being anti-disciplinary. So you have rest of MIT, which is very discipline-focused, and then you have Media Lab, where the motto is being anti-disciplinary, not belonging to any form of discipline whatsoever, and in fact, vigorously challenging certain kinds of disciplines. And there, we started sort of exploring a bunch of things in collaboration with the Center for Ethics that I founded in 2008, 2009, around sort of the whole idea of what actually education should focus on. And part of it was driven by the idea that you have one set of belief that we need to make kids more sensitive, more attuned to their emotional states and so on. And there were experiments that were done, including Montessori. In India and England, there were schools created by Krishnamurti called the JK schools, where the focus was largely around the idea of creativity, around expressions, self-expressions. And a lot of attention was given to the idea of nurturing the mind or cultivating the mind in certain capacity. Now, the dilemma with that was that we had very good kids, very brilliant kids, some geniuses as well. But they had tremendous amount of difficulty adapting to society. So once you leave the school and you try to enter the mainstream college education, it's sort of very challenging. And once you enter sort of, quote unquote, the mainstream society, it almost is alienating, almost sort of excruciatingly painful. And because you sensitize them so much, it becomes more so. So this was one of the challenges, is that where do we find the middle ground where we have one form of education where it's largely skill-based in certain ways, where the focus is mostly on acquiring certain kinds of know-how, but not so much in terms of the development or educating or nurturing the whole person or the whole human being. And on the other hand, you have certain systems that are overtly focused on the idea of nurturing the whole human being, but then, for the most part, they become sort of alienated with the larger society. And so where do you find actually middle grounds? And the second part of curiosity is around the idea that what is really the role of schools at this point in time? What is really the role of teachers, of educators at this point in time? Because for the most part, as we see today, in most developed societies, and even in some sort of underdeveloped nations where we are working, skill sets, you know, the traditional sort of imparting of knowledge around science, math, literature, and so on, is such that the online curriculums are doing very well. In fact, there are scenarios where kids learn better from online system than from teachers in classrooms. And that is going to be a continuous trend. We have algorithms that will begin to grade kids and perhaps begin to grade kids better, perhaps even more objectively at times. And whereas we have these kinds of sentimental arguments about the role of teacher in a classroom and what they should be doing, the reality of thing is that, you know, there is this Internet of Things that encompasses so much of knowledge, so much of data and information that traditionally teachers were simply giving into the classroom, that the role of a teacher becomes almost intermediary. It becomes facilitation. And if they're not trained to be better facilitators, they become obstacles, because kids prefer not to pay attention into classrooms because they think they can get that information someplace else at a convenient time in a convenient format. And even in something like Tibetan Children Village, the TCV schools in India, where technology is sort of a novelty, we see tremendous amount of success among students who are learning math and sciences, for example, from things like Khan Academy and other online tools than with teachers in classroom. So overall, then the question becomes, what is the role of classrooms in the future? Why should kids actually come into a classroom? Why should they be with a teacher? We have another experiment going on called around digital literacy that we tried as an experiment with certain villages in rural India where we simply hand out tablets. Tablets with sort of, you know, programs, content that kids can just self-organize and learn around it. And you see tremendous amount of curiosity around that kind of learning, meaning the dropout rate is much lower, even at a very early stage. Parents don't have to actually tell kids to go to school. Kids just show up because they want to play, they want to learn. And the content system is designed in such a manner where each tablet becomes tailored to a particular kid's strengths of how they learn, what they're learning at their pace. So they don't have to deal with the impatience of the teacher. The tablets are rather patient things. And there's no sort of impatience around how fast you're learning or a sense of urgency around what kind of grades you'll be getting or performance anxiety that students have in classrooms. So we are seeing some of those kinds of models that are doing very well. Again, I don't want to create the notion of a digital utopia. But as tools, these are very useful things. So then the question again becomes is, what is the role of a traditional classroom structure? What is the role of a teacher? And over the years, much of the conversation that I've been having with my colleagues, both at the lab and elsewhere, is that machine learning, AI, whatever it is that is going to replace this sort of transmission of data from human to human. One thing that it is not going to be doing in any foreseeable future is around empathy. It's around values of empathy. It is around values of emotions or how even kids learn about ethical decision making. But those are the things that we are not entirely sure whether machine learning can do or at least achieve, say, in the next 10 years or so. But those, ironically, do become some of the important criteria that have surfaced up, meaning that if kids are going to learn better in an education environment with digital tools, MOOC courses, and other forms of intermediary content delivery pathways, there's a gap, and this gap has been there in traditional school system as well, which is how do kids learn about becoming good human beings? How do kids learn about becoming good citizens? And more importantly, are these teachable things? Are these teachable criteria? Who has the responsibility to teach kids about emotional intelligence, or who has responsibility to teach kids about ethical decision making? Now, over the years, I have sort of made three distinct criteria between, because in the United States, my translation machine is working a bit slow. English is my fifth language, so sometimes I do have trouble with it. In the US, sometimes, you know, we do get sort of overzealous about creating movements around certain things. So whether it's mindfulness, whether it's SEL, whether it's something else, you know, we tend to create movements around these things, but not oftentimes thinking deeply about what the deliverable might be. Meaning, so if we were to envision what would an ideal educated, learned child look like? We are right now sort of simply looking at some of the gaps that an ideal, educated, learned child is experiencing, some of the gaps. The question is, can we envision what an ideal, educated, learned child would look like? Meaning that what form of learning, what form of curiosities, what form of dispositions are we going to impart to these kids? That's where I think the dilemma is, partly. Because we all have sort of different kinds of focus on what this ideal kid should look like. See, whether they should be smart in problem solving, whether they should be smart in certain kinds of problem solving, whether they should be just, you know, good with certain forms of decision-making processes that makes them good citizens, that makes them, meaning that we actually don't have a very good template for what a good human being should look like. We have templates for saints, and we have templates for, you know, very high sort of role models that we seldom think about. And if we think about, we don't sort of really take them that seriously. In a way that, I'll give you an example. How many of you have used a syntax, a structure, whenever you have associated yourself with a failure, or whenever you have associated yourself with not completing something or a sign of weakness? How many of you have resorted to a statement such as, I'm just a human being. Some of you? It's a common expression in English, right? I'm just a human being. Now, how many of you recall that when you have actually achieved something and you were congratulated for it, you were given awards, that the first sentence that came out of your mouth was, I'm just a human being? So let me ask you a simple question. When do we learn this reference point of being a human being with failure and weaknesses? How do we learn it? When do we learn that being a human is actually associated with weaknesses and failures, even if we use those kinds of expressions? So there are these kinds of challenges that run much deeper, in my view, when we talk about things around, you know, encouraging kids to learn about purpose and encouraging kids to learn about decision making that have sort of long-term impact or long-term consequences. So for me, this is more of an opportunity simply to have a conversation around the idea of what do you believe or what do you think should be role of teachers? Should be role of teachers in a classroom, which is how traditionally we have learned, at least in the last 200 years, to impart education. If the premise is that the kids are actually going to learn the traditional form of learning more from other kinds of sources other than the teacher in the classroom, what should that teacher be doing? What should that teacher be actually teaching, modeling, imparting to the kids in classroom? And this is where sort of part of my curiosity around reframing what education should be like. The second part of it, before I open up for conversations, is a work that I'm investing some time in, which is around ethics, around values and decision making. And it is from a emerging from sort of a simple struggle, which is that increasingly we live in a secular society. And not that I favor religious anyways, but we live in a secular society, and the traditional models that we had of platforms or avenues around talking about ethics or talking about values, they're sort of breaking down, you see. So initially, you know, there were, in most societies, even the one that I grew up in, you had grandparents and parents, large families, there will be discussions around values and ethics, norms, and so on. Increasingly, that's not the reality. That's not the reality in this country. Single mothers don't have time to sit down and talk about ethics and values with their kids. Most people are becoming secular by their worldview, and if they are becoming religious, it gives some limited interaction or some limited orientation around such discussion, mostly pertaining to their belief system. Schools and education systems don't talk about ethics. They don't actually provide a platform, a wholesome platform, to discuss about ethics and values. You get to universities, and unless you volunteer to take an ethics 101 class, or if you're in a Jesuit university, it becomes a core requirement, in which case it's the most boring course you will ever take. And you will have no retention of what you learned in Ethics 101 after you graduate from university. And that was probably your only introduction to ethics. And then you get out of these institutions of higher education and you go to work. And these are some of the individuals that you trust with your money, you trust with your policies, and you trust in leading the country, like the current scenario, who's going to become your president. Can you imagine that 300 million people in a first world country and the two candidates that you have? We simply believe that ethics is magical, that somehow people are just going to be good, that people are just going to become good, somehow. Somehow, in all these formation periods, whatever education we are imparting to them, whatever interaction they may have, that by the time they occupy whatever position they are supposed to occupy in civil society, that magically they are going to become good human beings. For me, that's the biggest gamble as a society that we have, the biggest gamble. That we believe that if you want to be a good athlete, we spend gazillions of dollars and gazillions of hours training them to become good athletes. If we believe that we should train them to become better scientists, we again spend a lot of time, a lot of resources training them to become scientists. But this concept of being good, ethical human being, somehow it's magical. It doesn't require any time, doesn't require any resource input. But somehow, they will just come out and be good. And this is the dilemma, this is the challenge, I think, that we as a world, and that's why you see increasingly the sense of leadership deficit globally. You see, that it's not that, you know, you can call it whatever you want to call it with a decorative language like the Axial Age and whatnot, but the fact is that we haven't invested in what it means to be a good human being. And so again, the issue falls back on what is one institution representative of a civic society that can actually make a dent in this issue, and that's education. But the challenge again is that as education institutions, are we willing to rethink what it is that we are imparting, how the division of labor should be set aside, and so on. So maybe I'll leave it at that, and I'll leave it at some encouraging news, which is more of a PR thing for at least two universities, which is slightly encouraging. Again, I don't know how they're going to go about it, because evidence-based science these days is very wishy-washy in some regards. And I'm saying that having been trained as a physicist academically. The Dean of Admissions at Harvard and MIT signed off on this pact that the incoming students, at least in these two universities, and I'm hoping that other universities will follow, that the incoming students will not only be evaluated on their GPAs and other forms of performances, but they will actually be also evaluated on things like empathy and compassion and other criterias. Criterias that are good news for social emotional learning and other forms of things that we associate with good citizenship and so on. The question, of course, becomes is how are we going to evaluate that? Over a child's lifetime, the entire learning curve, how are we going to evaluate by the time they enter into college to say that, okay, these are good signals that this kid is actually a compassionate kid and is ranking higher in compassion and ranking higher in other kinds of desirable values as compared to other kids? And the second question again becomes is, will that create unintended consequences, unintended problems around competitive environment with regards to values themselves? But at least the good news is that there are two mainstream educational institutions that have accepted the idea that it's a good idea. I'm always reminded of this thing. When Gandhi once was asked, you know, what he thought of Western civilization. Do you know this? The journalist asked Gandhi what he thought of Western civilization, and his response was, it's a good idea. It's a good idea that at least two leading universities have accepted this purview of saying that we should look into compassion and other things that we, you know, even a decade ago dismissed simply as soft skills. You know, the idea that soft skills are the desirable skills that we should be importing into students. So these are a couple of things that I wanted to just put out for conversations. One is, How do you envision the role of teachers and educators, such as you and I, in future classrooms? And the second would be around the sense of, you know, how do you envision a good human being? What does a good human being look like? What would be the template? What is the template for that? Both from learning and other models. And the third thing would be around the idea of that if universities are going to take a lead and begin to evaluate kids on quote-unquote soft skills such as compassion and empathy and other sort of values, what do you think should be some of the metrics? What do you think should be some of the even comparative analysis that we could offer to say this would be a good direction to go into? So maybe I'll take a pause there and we can just have a conversation about it. I'm sure most of you have thought much longer and harder than I have on these issues, so.
To answer your second question, what is virtuous citizen look like? I'm at a Catholic school and have been for the last 11 years. The two things that are really easy, I think, for parents and students to buy into is the idea that students should come into school kind of thinking narrowly and living in a little bubble, but when they leave, it's bigger. Mm-hmm. They think of themselves as global citizens and have, you know, understanding that they didn't have before. And then that understanding grows into some sort of concern, and they want to take some sort of action. So some idea of like service learning, that they have some sort of commitment to doing something for the greater good.
Okay.
Those two things I think are essential for what I try to do, what I think is being done in Catholic schools and public schools.
Right. I think certain Catholic schools are very good at it. I was educated by Jesuits, so I can vouch for that. It's weird to be a Buddhist monk educated by Jesuits all my life. But they have done a very good job at it. And learning, service learning is one of the components, okay. But again, the template of a good human being. Uh-huh.
Whether that's happening or not. And my feeling is that there's probably a real mistrust of someone else providding that for your child.
Right.
That's probably a barrier.
Right.
There's still the idea that that's where it's coming from, even if it's not.
Right.
And then who are these people to try to instruct
my child in
these sorts of things?
I think that's a number one challenge. I mean, we have been piloting this program called Transformative Teachers. And it's more of an issue that we find in US than even, say, in Mexico or India, where we have been running competitive demographics, is the division of role is not that clear. And in fact, people feel threatened. The parents feel threatened by teachers, and teachers feel threatened by parents. And unfortunately, the child is the victim. You know, they are the ones who are getting mixed messages. So you can walk into a classroom with all the good intention that today I'm going to teach you about this and how to handle complex scenarios with these kinds of emotional states. The parents might actually think otherwise. They might actually accuse you of weakening the kids. So part of the thing is that, you know, how do we get parents and teachers on the same platform when it comes to child? And PTA meetings, unfortunately, are not those platforms. So part of the thing is that, you know, can we envision again a different kind of platform for this particular conversation to happen?
I guess for me on the data gathering side, we have quantitative data, and I think what we're searching for in this question is what's the qualitative data?
Mm-hmm.
And so doing it that way kind of breaks the norm, so you have to kind of get your idea of quantitative data out and maybe look at it differently, you know, take a different perspective on it, I think.
Right. What would be some of the things that you would want to see as a qualitative data?
I think when you talk about morals and ethics, then it becomes not a one-word type of checklist, multiple-choice item. You know, you have to kind of dig deep and really see what are you looking for. You know, and I don't think it's a multiple-choice thing. You know, you have to, I don't know. Sometimes it's not quantifiable.
Right.
So.
See, the benefit of one thing is that, you know, so my one side of my education, which was traditionally the Indian model of education, was more like an apprentice model. You know, we had this gurukul system up until mid-17th century, early 18th century, until a British viceroy decided that they needed to have more administrators and civil servants. And there's some theory as to, you know, the current sort of design of education system was actually enforced by these guys over the last 150 years. But in the apprentice model, you actually had the ability as a teacher to relate to kids and look at the holistic development and do these kinds of qualitative analysis. But when you have 60 or 100 kids in the classroom, you just cannot do that, right? So what would be some of the qualitative things that you're looking at? Because at the end of the day, you're still relying on certain metrics, right, to do this. But the bottom line is that what we are struggling with these things is, ideally we want the kids to be more empathetic, more kind, and so on, but we do not have good metrics. We don't have agreeable metrics. These things, right?
I guess consistency, industriousness, you know, something stick to it.
Okay.
That kind of stuff that, I don't know.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. So, for example, if you're dealing with values, right, that is an internal belief system, right? I value my family over mm-hmm. my work or whatever mm-hmm. the case may be. You can't,
right.
And you can look at behaviors associated with that. You spend more time at work than you do it with your family, but it's right. still a sentiment.
Mm-hmm.
And then you look at skill sets,
right?
And you can't ask people about their skill sets, at least that's what our research shows, because mm-hmm. people are just grossly unself-aware. Right, about their abilities. So if you want to know their preferences, easy. You like Thai food or you like mashed potatoes and burgers?
Right.
Not a problem.
Right.
So I think a lot of it is differentiating kind of what it is that is of great, of, you know, what variable,
right.
you know, are we speaking about? And then each of those variables has different ways of measuring it. So right. from an emotional intelligence standpoint, right, it needs to be measured as an ability because it is an ability.
Okay.
Do you follow? So you can't ask me it's very hard to judge someone's ability to read facial expressions accurately.
Uh-huh.
Right? Like you've got to give them the facial expressions, develop systems to...
Unless you're Paul Ekman.
Yeah.
Right.
Well, right, but he's, that's his whole training, right?
Right.
That's his whole background.
Right.
Anyway, so I just think that part of it is defining these things more clearly. And, you know, people don't agree on what empathy means, right? People don't agree on what compassion means. People don't agree on what self-awareness means.
Right.
So then it starts back from operationalizing the constructs in many ways.
So part of the, yes, please go ahead.
I also worry a little bit, you know, when we're saying like, well, we want our kids to be empathetic and uh-huh. kind, and we're going to reward that when we see that. I feel like, you know, when you're empathetic and you're kind, you're not doing it. It's an intrinsically motivated thing.
Right.
And so once you start labeling it and giving them an A for empathetic behavior,
right.
that takes the intrinsic motivation away from that and just right. sort of, it moves it in the realm of like, well, I want to get into MIT or Harvard, so
right.
I better be empathetic.
Well, and that's what we see, which is like the imitation scenario, right?
Yeah.
So. Ape-like kindness versus genuine kindness, right? But the question is, how do you decipher that? You know?
Yeah, I was just related to some of these questions. Yeah. I also think we were asking what makes a good person, an ethical person.
Yeah.
I worry a little bit about
no, a good human being.
Even a good human being, even a good. I'm saying this is a good human being
right.
versus a bad human being.
Right.
It's the behavior
mm-hmm.
that's
mm-hmm.
truly the good or bad.
Okay.
as opposed to labeling someone that, because mm-hmm. then I think you get people into a very, can get people into a very fixed mindset
about
I am either good or bad,
or
that person is either good or bad.
Right.
So I just,
I agree with that. But there is the scenario, you know, unfortunately, or fortunately with us, which is that we do tend to learn better with these kinds of models around with having heroes or role models, right? And we do tend to do that until we find out something not so good about our role model. And then we try to flip the role models in that. The question that I'm asking is simply that it's not so much to create like this kind of a binary movement around good or bad. But the thing is that we are talking about good human beings, good citizenships, these kinds of criteria. How do we envision it? What does it look like?
Well, I think, you know, in some ways, we're almost making it more complicated than it needs to be.
Okay.
Because really, if you think about it, what are you looking for? You're looking for someone that helps others.
Uh-huh.
Right? I mean, I think almost any tradition would say if someone puts time and effort into helping others, then they're good. And even if they're doing it to get into MIT, Harvard, you know, doing their, like, community service hours, right?
Okay.
And so it looks good on a transcript. Still, they did the community service, and it will affect them.
Okay.
So
even if it's with ulterior motive, it's fine as long as...
I think it could still, you know, it's still going to have a positive effect. I mean, if you look at it in a big picture.
Kind of. Okay, all right.
I think everybody in this room can identify what love or empathy feel like, but nobody can hold that in their hand. I can't hold love in my hand, so you know it's difficult to measure something when it's abstract. So when I hear these comments, I just think about, you know, children who are given the skills in terms of numeracy, literacy, but more importantly, their connection to like all that is. You know, kids that understand, you know, their power, they can understand their connectivity to their planet and its inhabitants. Mm-hmm. And if you're connected or if you feel connected to what's actually happening, you're a lot more likely to exude things like compassion, exude things like love, because you have an appreciation for it. So, you know, I think it's really more about encouraging them to act on their highest excitement to the best of their abilities without hurting themselves or hurting anyone else. And
if
you did that, you'd naturally align yourself with an energy that's ultimately going to result in things like empathy or compassion.
Okay. Yeah. See, I'll give you one scenario. And I'm just, you know, using some of these scenarios just to understand things better. So we recently had a program at MIT with a bunch of teachers from, they were from all over North America. It was a mixed demographic of teachers. And we were talking about, you know, just a simple evaluation of values. You know, so these were values that the teachers had proposed, and it was just there sitting on the whiteboard. And they were labeling it as, you know, positive, negative, or neutral values based on desirability and so on. And then we came across a word called venerable. Vulnerable. How many of you think it's a negative trait to be vulnerable, to teach kids to be vulnerable?
I am vulnerable.
Sorry. And I hope you tease them to be venerables as well, but vulnerable, yes. Venerable in qualities, not in age. Yes. Vulnerable. How many of you think it's a positive quality? That you actually want to foster that as a thing in kids? You know, this group of teachers was divided. You see, almost 80% thought it was a negative quality and 20% thought it was a positive one. So part of the thing is that even when we are promoting something like connection, and this connection at times requires the sense of openness, a sense of being vulnerable, but if the teacher is not decided which way to take it, you see, what to make of that thing, those are some of the dilemmas, you see, that surfaces. And the question is then, you know, how do we navigate that? No. Now, if the kids are mature, you can give them the decision-making tools and say, think for yourself, you know, come up with a scenario and talk about it. But when you're teaching middle school or below, okay, they're waiting for some cues from you as teachers, right? And so the question becomes then, what your preferences are, which gets transmitted into what you tell the kids about it.
I just kind of keep thinking of this quote from Phillips Exeter, the Deed of Gift, that says, knowledge without goodness is dangerous, mm-hmm. and goodness without knowledge is weak and feeble,
right.
and only the two united form the noblest of characters. And so it seems like the two are very wed into a person of character, mm-hmm. a venerable person such as yourself.
I'm trying to be venerable. I was just joking about it. Yes.
And I can't, the idea of something tangible,
right.
you know, you can hold that paper that you wrote and somebody gave you an A on.
Right.
The idea of being, seen as a good person or felt as
right.
a good person, that seems very sort of elusive.
Right. And that's where the challenge is. See, if you take the traditional pedagogy, and I'm freely using the word Buddhism here, largely because of, you know, some of the thought formation has happened because of Buddhist curriculums and all. But there are things that are defined as measurable, and there are things that are defined as immeasurables. Right? And so we have measurable criteria of certain things, but then there are things that Buddhists are saying, leave it alone. Okay? Let them be immeasurables. Okay? And because the moment we try to start actually defining metrics for those kinds of things, we might actually run into different kind of complex scenarios. We might try to convince ourselves that we have good metrics for it. Okay? But are we going to try to make them universal metrics? Will that be another form of imperialism? Okay? So part of the thing is, again, that while we're trying to promote, you know, a certain aptitude, a certain kind of, a certain set of dispositions among the youth, the question becomes is, do we really want it to be measurable? Okay. And if we cannot measure it, can we actually gauge that kids are actually making progress? Meaning, simply because if we label something as immeasurable and say, I don't want any metrics for it, does it make it unobservable in the eyes of teachers or in the eyes of society?
It's that Einstein quote, right? It's where you're going. With everything that counts. Everything that can be counted counts. Everything that can't be counted does, or however that one goes.
Yes? I'm sure Fred remembers that.
Not everything that counts can be counted.
Can be counted. How about the first question? Everybody jumped on the second one. What would be your role in the future classrooms? How do you see it?
I feel like the role goes back to what you were talking about before, more of like an apprenticeship, so like a mentoring, facilitative, inspiring kind of relationship, less a deliverer of information.
Okay.
What I was going to say, one of the things that drives me crazy is when people try to teach passion.
Uh-huh.
And I always say it's like our job to create the conditions,
uh-huh.
right, for kids to develop purpose and passion.
Right, right, right.
So I think that's, broadly speaking, what I would like to see more of.
So to foster conditions for purpose and passion.
For self-discovery.
For self-discovery, okay.
I think jumping on Mark's point a little bit too, I mean, there's some things that, you know, you can directly instruct, you
uh-huh.
know, and then some things that you can try to directly instruct and actually sort of spoil it for the kids. And
uh-huh.
so if you're trying to cultivate a set of dispositions, I mean, I can tell you, you know what, I want you to be more empathetic, okay?
Uh-huh.
Right? But that would just piss me off, and
right.
I would say, what is that even? But if you are the teacher and you are modeling that behavior without even talking about it,
right?
You know, I think that's the primary role of adults in general and teachers particularly.
Right. So this is a important distinction also. I'm glad you brought it up, which is between teaching values versus teaching with values. Right? Teaching values almost never works. Right? And this is, again, another form of conditioning that we see, that, you know, if you identify that these are the things that perhaps teachers can be doing or should be doing in the classroom, how do you train them to do that? So even when we run program around ethics and emotions and values, purpose, when teachers walk into seminar, they actually expect to walk out with binders. Pretty much 95% of them are disappointed when they don't see a binder in the room, which should have lesson plans, which should have exercises that they could just basically take that, walk into the classroom, and teach kids about values, which values, and how to go about it. And for the first year, I actually felt very bad. I felt like I was doing something really wrong because there were so many teachers walking out with disappointment. But this is part of the challenge, is that when you look at actually education curriculums that trains teachers also, which has to do with, so you have certain body of knowledge, certain set of knowledge, and now you have come to accept the fact that the Internet of Things holds, you know, probably 10x times more information than you humanly can. And given that all technological scenarios are working, that is going to be more accessible. The question becomes then is, what sort of alternate lesson plans do we create for teachers? What sort of alternate lesson plans do we create for teachers so that they can actually complement this learning rather than competing with this form of tools? Because even to this day, a lot of classrooms that we see where teachers are like, I'll beat the computer. I'll produce knowledge much faster than the computer can do. And for the last 20 years, it was a nice thing to do. You know, people sort of competed with it. But the processing power of things are becoming such that probably should not be the ambition. Right? But the gap, again, is how do teachers complement this form of learning in classrooms? So what kind of tools do we need for that?
In a teaching role, that I think you have to know your students and not go in with a blanket lesson plan of teaching with values or of values, but know where they come from and understand where they are.
Right.
The diversity of our students means that there's different levels of values, or not levels, but different perspectives on values and ethics, morality, and as soon as we start saying, we want to see this type,
right.
You close down global mindedness, international mindedness, and
right. Just to be clear, I'm not suggesting that we should have that.
No, I know that. So. If you're asking about the role of a teacher,
yes.
It's one of being open-minded and providing, I think someone said it, providing opportunities to explore what that might be with their peers. And maybe it's not us mentoring, but they're mentoring each other so that they can work it out.
Okay.
Rather than us show them how to do it.
So the reason I'm pushing on this is because part of my other role, I wear several hats, part of my other role these days is working on artificial intelligence and ethics. And so one of the things that we're looking at is on the other side of specialized ethics, which has to do with, you know, it's like, you know, IBM Watson, it's doing these oncology trials in certain parts. And 70% of the times, a group of human doctors often are wrong compared to what Watson diagnoses, right? But many a times these doctors are, you know, they went through med school. They spent a lot of time. There's ego trips. They are not going to listen to a computer tell them that they're wrong, right? But when you look at the data, almost 70% of the time, Watson is right, right? Part of the challenge is that how do humans complement this kind of relationship? So here, in education scenario, if we are going to use, which we are increasingly, tools around machine learning and AI in teaching kids, in a very specialized manner, what are some of the tools that the teacher should have? What are some of the tools that you would say, if I was going to get my bachelor's or master's of education again, to become a teacher. These are some of the tools that I think I should ideally have to become an ideal teacher in a future classroom. And that future could be in 3 years from now. What would some of those tools be?
I think integrity would be one of those tools, because like, I really like what you said about knowing your audience. You know, like I'm from New York, and you got kids that even if they had the most advanced technology in the world, that's less important to them mm-hmm. than seeing somebody that they think they relate to, or seeing themselves in someone, or seeing someone that they feel that uh-huh. they have a connection to have integrity and carry themselves that way. So you get to model that for them.
Okay.
And you know, that's a pretty
So cool modeling thing. Integrity. Yeah. Okay. Yeah. Other thoughts? Yeah.
Adaptability and flexibility. Uh-huh.
Right,
Sorry.
Right.
Wave and building empathy, and I think that being adaptable and flexible, coupled with that same idea with technology, I think can definitely revolutionize the classroom.
Okay. Are these not part of masses of education curriculum these days?
You know, there's a lot of times when we are in the four walls uh-huh. and you are the master of that uh-huh. and you have the control of that. And I think that's the growth mindset that needs to change because it goes beyond the four walls when they leave the classroom. When right. you leave the classroom, we are preparing these kids, these young minds, to go out and be our bosses, uh-huh. make our future for us, and are giving them the right skill sets, we hope. But we need to give up that power. And it comes from them, empowering them to know that their voice is heard, their decisions are made with discernment, and model them. You know, the action does speak. You know, it means more than words, just your words here. I think that it, what I wanted to say earlier too is that when you interview somebody for a position, they may have the right answers, uh-huh. Or they might have, you know, the right skills, or the degree and whatnot. But you cannot teach them how to have heart. Mm-hmm. And when you have a discussion, interaction with them, or see them in action, you know that that person has heart, and you gotta grab them for your team. Mm-hmm. And but I don't know how to. It's just a gut feeling sometimes. It is hard to measure.
I think curiosity and investigation. You know, you can almost perceive a world. I don't know where you are in AI with this. I'd be very interested to hear. But a machine can figure things out and can maybe even research things. But can they think outside the box? You know, can they lead to further inquiry and question? You know, you can almost think of a world at some point where the robots do everything, but nothing changes for 100 years. You know?
Right.
Because nobody has the ability, you know, they just let somebody else do it. I don't need to think about it. You know, just I don't know that you'll ever get, will we ever get past that where, you know, it's human beings that created all this, you know, all the advances, all the technology to begin with. And so there has to be that continual question and imagination.
So let me ask you this. You go for a job interview to become a middle school teacher. How many of you are middle school teachers here? Some? High school? Okay. You go for a job interview to a middle or high school teaching position. And the question, one of the interview questions is, well, we expect you to model integrity, model kindness, model compassion, model curiosity, so that you're not showing any form of dogmatic behavior in the classroom. So, How many of you truly think that you're prepared to sign off on that as teachers? If that was the interview question, and that was expected of you as teachers,
I think it would be easier to sign on and say, I'll try to model it, than I'll teach it.
No, we're not asking, they're not going to teach. We're not asking about teaching. We're just saying you're to model integrity.
Right. I guess I would want to say that I'm so thrilled that this conference is actually encouraging us to struggle with these things.
Mm-hmm.
Because I think that we are too quick to shy away from teaching values, or because of all of the reasons that we've already articulated.
Right.
Our children deserve to struggle with this as well.
Exactly.
And to grow in values and these kinds of things, character.
Right.
And I'm afraid that we get too concerned that we might not be teaching the right way, or what the parents might expect of us, that we start being more and more silent about it, and that's dangerous as well, I believe.
Yeah, I agree with you. I think it is dangerous. Yep.
I think that we grossly underestimate how amazing most teachers are.
Mm-hmm.
And I feel like in our work in schools, when we ask people to think about these things, which we do, like around integrity, is just throwing it out to the teachers and asking them to define it for mm-hmm. their building, for their school. And it's amazing, you know, these conversations that come about. Instead of us trying to define everything,
right.
just allow the audience themselves to think about these concepts.
Right.
And we find they come up with amazing, very specific goals and strategies in order to create more or demonstrate integrity or to show different things.
Right. No, I agree with that. The issue that I'm raising right now is more about tools. The issue that I'm raising more right now is more about preparedness. It's not about sentiments around integrity. It's not even questioning whether one has the capacity to have integrity or not. It's more about the tools and so on that we can have in that scenario.
But the tools then sound like how to ask really good questions.
Right.
How to get people to think about these things in deep ways and lead people through discussions
on
that's
what it
is really what's important, and learning how to do that well and to help people think through together in a community sense sometimes
too,
it seems really critical.
Are these kinds of conversations that you have with parents during PTA meetings? Sometimes, okay.
The question about integrity, like in my mind, integrity doesn't mean perfection.
Sure.
To be asked that in an interview, I think integrity has more to do with willingness and intention,
right?
And so I think if I were asked that question, it's sort of the cliche response, I do my best, but you know, I would want to model the things that I would want the students to learn.
And I'm
sort of stuck earlier, you used the word vulnerable.
Yeah.
You know, I feel like being vulnerable is really an essential component for me as a teacher.
Mm-hmm.
I teach music, and so yes, we're learning skills and concepts and elements of music and music history and how to play things, but we're also learning really abstract kinds of concepts about what is beauty and what is emotion and what is expression. And so I feel my modeling, you know, my own appreciation and attempting to understand what those things mean for my students evokes those responses in them and creates an atmosphere where they feel safer.
Right.
I mean, I know I have students that I've had, because I teach actually elementary at a private school, elementary, middle, and high school, so I've had kids from the time they're 9 years old to the time they're 18, and when they come to me and they're in high school and they'll, you know, talk about a piece of music, the Brahms was so beautiful. Well, there, I feel like through that, I am developing social-emotional ideas of beauty and expression and connectedness with humanity and all those big, lofty things that are not really lofty. They're
critical things.
That's
wonderful. That's wonderful, and I completely agree. Again, you know, I'm not giving you definitions of values. These are some of the terms that you raised. The thing that I'm simply asking is, because, you know, Venerable being an example that came up in this discussion, that, you know, sometimes we simply assume as a teaching community that we agree on certain values, even in terms of whether it's desirability or not, right? But seldom do teachers actually have an opportunity to have these conversations. How many times do you actually, on any given day or in even a given month, actually interact as teachers, as colleagues, and talk about shared values or questioning values or exploring them? But this is where the dilemma happens, is that if you have a sense of clarity about how you perceive vulnerability, you're able to start a conversation. Some students may agree with it, some may not agree with it. But the fact is that there are those who don't have clarity about it. One of the biggest things that we found around values is how people tell stories to themselves about certain values. When we started teaching, we started, you know, designing these programs actually for business schools, right? And my favorite story is that this is 2008, 2009. We are teaching a program called Transformative Leadership in three of the topmost business schools in the country. And we would ask these business leaders and some MBA students to talk about what are some of the values of a business leader, some of the qualities of a business leader, a successful business leader. Mind you, this is 2008, 2009, right? In every conversation, it would take an hour and a half on an average time, after much prodding, for people to come up with things like honesty and integrity. First, I thought it was a happenstance. It was an accidental thing. I asked a colleague to run it at another school, same issue. I asked another colleague to run it, same issue. I ran it at Sloan again, same issue. And this is part of the challenge, is that we may think we are imbibing a certain set of value, but there's a tremendous amount of gap between manifesting it and understanding of it. And the thing that I'm raising as a problem is that we actually don't have that many avenues or platforms in our education system to actually bridge that gap. And I believe you as teachers do an excellent job, and you have an excellent platform to actually bridge that gap. That's where I think we will begin to address some of these leadership deficit issues that we are facing today. So thank you again, and thank you so very much for all the wonderful things that you do.